Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to cover how to determine partial structures in a proton NMR. So this is where you would be interpreting an actual spectrum, and you're working backwards from the signal, the integration, the chemical shift, to get a partial structure that then you can use to link together an entire structure. So I like to start with the integration. So I have an integration of two there. That tells me that there's two of that type of proton. Since the integration is less than 3, it's probably a CH2. It doesn't have to be, it could be symmetry, but it might be a CH2, it's most likely to be. And so I'm gonna start from the integration with a CH2. Then I'm gonna look at the splitting. So the signal, remember, is split into N plus one peaks. And in this case, we have a quartet. So N plus one equals 4. So N has gotta equal 3. So that tells me that I have 3 neighbors on this molecule. And again, I could have 2 on one side and 1 on the other, but you know, a CH3 is probably a good bet. So I'm gonna put the CH3 next door, and this information I got from my splitting. So this is the peak is generated from that CH2. It has a CH3 next to it. And then lastly, I'm gonna look at my chemical shift. So my chemical shift tells me about the electronegativity of my neighbor, or the type of carbon that it's on or is next door to, the type of atom. And so at 3.5, it's significantly downfield. That tells me that this carbon is probably directly attached to some kind of heteroatom. So I don't have a molecular formula in this particular example. The way I could draw my partial structure is just to say that's probably directly attached to X because of my chemical shift. So you should get familiar with reading your chemical shift chart and interpreting chemical shift. But look how much we just put together. We have the CH2 that we were interested in that came from our integration, but now we know about this neighbor and this neighbor. So we have a kind of a big chunk of this molecule just from using those three pieces: our integration, our splitting, and our chemical shift. So let's try another example. I like to start with my integration so I know sort of what I'm focusing on and where my neighbors should come from there. So here's the peak that I'm starting with. This is the proton that is generating that signal. It's got an integration of 1, so it's just a CH. And then I can go and look at my splitting. This is a high multiplicity peak. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is called a sextet. And so N plus 1 is equal to 6, so N is equal to 5. I can't fit 5 neighbors on one atom, right? That's not going to work. So the most I can have if it's attached to something else is a CH3. So if I think about a CH3, that's 3 of my neighbors, right? So maybe then I also need a CH2. This is a carbon that's inside of a chain. So on one side, I'm going to put a CH3, and then on the other side, I'm going to put a CH2. And those two things, those two neighbors, came from my splitting, okay? So that's from the splitting down here. I'm gonna go back to red here. And then the last thing is my chemical shift. And so it's between 2 and 3. That's a little bit downfield to just have like a carbon that's sp3 hybridized as a neighbor. And so probably I have either a slightly electronegative atom, or maybe I have a carbon that's sp2 hybridized, like a carbonyl compound or a benzene ring. So if you have a molecular formula, you might have a better idea of exactly what that is. But to do it generically, you could say a carbon that is sp2 hybridized, or maybe it's like a nitrogen or a sulfur. When you have a molecular formula, you'll know all the things it's not, right? Because they're not in there. So if there's no nitrogen in your molecular formula, it's not attached to a nitrogen. So that can give us a little more information. But here's an example where we saw a high multiplicity peak, which generally means an internal carbon inside of a linear chain, having neighbors with protons on either side of it. And that's also influenced by chemical shift. It's a little further downfield than we would expect if it was just part of an alkyl chain with no other functional groups on it. And so we can look to our chemical shift chart and see that between 2 and 3 parts per million, we have H's on carbons that are next to less electronegative atoms or pi systems, sp2 hybridized carbons. All right, one more example, and in this we're gonna look at some symmetry. So you can see I have a high integration of 6. The highest number of protons that can be on a carbon that's attached to something else is 3. In a previous video, I talked about how if you have multiples of 3, it's very likely that those are methyl groups that are in identical chemical environments. And so here, the way that we can draw our partial structure is to draw 2 CH3s that are coming off of the same carbon atom. So they would be in an identical chemical environment. So this is how I get 6 as my total integration. And then if I look to my splitting, I have N plus 1 equals 2. In this case, it's a doublet. So N equals 1. There's only one proton on the neighboring carbon atom. So there's a proton here. And then this must be attached to something else, but it's not a proton. So not H. And the chemical shift is 0.8. That makes sense. You've got 2 CH3s attached to another carbon, this carbon here, and there's no heteroatom coming off of it or anything that we can see right here, but these are terminal, these CH3s on the end that are responsible for your signal. And so that's an appropriate chemical shift for a terminal CH3 group. So there are a few examples of how you can take spectral data and convert that into structural information that you can then use to solve an entire puzzle. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends, and I'll see you next time.